The story of Giordano Bruno begins in the Kingdom of Naples, Italy, where in the small town of Nola a baby named Filippo Bruno was born in 1548. As with many great tales, his humble beginning belied the extraordinary life he was destined to lead, one filled with bold ideas, daring truths, and an indomitable spirit. As a child, Filippo showed an insatiable thirst for knowledge, eager to learn and explore the world beyond the narrow streets of Nola. As he grew older, this drive only intensified, guiding him towards a path few dared to tread. When he was 17, in 1565, Filippo made a life-changing decision. He joined the Dominican order at the monastery of San Domenico Maggiore in Naples, shedding his birth name and adopting a new one, Giordano. This step marked the beginning of his journey into the world of philosophy and theology, a journey that would lead him to challenge the status quo and redefine humanity's understanding of the universe. Within the austere walls of the monastery, Giordano Bruno the Dominican friar was ordained as a priest in 1572. This should have been a proud moment, an affirmation of his faith and commitment to the church. However, Bruno's inquisitive mind was not content to simply accept the prevailing interpretations of Scripture and the nature of God. He found himself drawn to ideas that were deemed unconventional, even heretical. Bruno's unique interpretations of religious texts and his pursuit of a deeper understanding of the cosmos brought him into conflict with the leaders of the monastery. By 1576, accusations of heresy began to swirl around him. In a time when such accusations could lead to dire consequences, Bruno chose to not cower or recant. Instead, he stood by his convictions, a decision that forced him to leave the comfort and security of the monastery and venture into the world as a wanderer. This marked the beginning of his life as an itinerant scholar, a life that would lead him to far-off lands and into the hearts and minds of some of the most influential figures of his time. With the accusations of heresy hanging over his head, Bruno had to flee from the home he'd known, trading the familiar stone halls of the monastery for the uncertainties of the road. He journeyed first to Rome, then onwards, eventually reaching the bustling city of Geneva in 1579. Geneva was a refuge, a beacon of the Protestant Reformation and an academic hub that welcomed thinkers and scholars from all corners of Europe. The city became a sanctuary for Bruno, a place where he could continue his studies and express his ideas openly without fear of reprisal. But Geneva was more than just a haven for him, it was a place of discovery and development. There, he found a community of like-minded individuals, people who were also seeking to understand the world beyond what the church had prescribed. His ideas began to take shape, to evolve, influenced by the discourse and debates that were part and parcel of Geneva's intellectual climate. But despite the relative safety that Geneva offered, Bruno was not one to stay put. His restless spirit urged him to keep moving, to continue exploring. In 1581, Bruno moved to Paris. The City of Lights welcomed him with open arms, enamored by his charm and intrigued by his revolutionary ideas. His skills and memory training caught the attention of the French court and earned him a reputation as a respected academic. Bruno's fame grew, and so did his influence. It was here in Paris that he published his first work on the art of memory, De Umbris Idearum, in 1582. This work not only demonstrated his innovative thinking, but also his conviction in challenging established norms. For Bruno, memory was more than just a cognitive function, it was an art form, a way to explore the depths of human understanding and perception. His ideas captivated audiences, sparking interest and curiosity in the minds of those fortunate enough to hear him speak. His time in Paris, however, was not to be a long sojourn. As with many innovative thinkers, Bruno's ideas attracted as much controversy as they did admiration. Nonetheless, his fame had spread far and wide, and it wasn't long before he found himself journeying across the English Channel to England in 1583. He arrived bearing a recommendation from none other than Henry III of France, a testament to his growing influence. The land of Shakespeare and Elizabeth I was a fertile ground for intellectual discourse, with its universities and scholarly circles teeming with fresh perspectives and dynamic debates. Here, Bruno delved further into his philosophical musings, refining and consolidating his theories. The culmination of this was his groundbreaking work, The Expulsion of the Triumphant Beast, published in 1584. Through this philosophical allegory, Bruno not only made a powerful case for his belief in an infinite universe and the existence of multiple worlds, but also presented a vision of the universe that was truly revolutionary, challenging the dominant paradigms of the time. Each page was imbued with his daring spirit and irrepressible curiosity, a testament to the bravery of a man who dared to think differently. Yet, the landscape of Bruno's life was always changing. In 1585, he found himself back in Paris, drawn back by the promise of a receptive audience and an environment that encouraged philosophical inquiry. However, his return was marred by an attempted assassination of Henry III, an event that sent shockwaves through the nation and turned the political climate on its head. Amidst this chaos and uncertainty, Bruno found himself facing hostility and suspicion once more. His beliefs and teachings were scrutinized, challenged, and rejected by those who saw them as a threat to the established order. Bruno, the man who had once been a welcomed scholar and acclaimed philosopher, found himself an outsider once again. Yet, even in the face of such adversity, Bruno did not back down. Instead, he chose to leave the city he had once called home, moving eastward to Wittenberg, Germany, in 1586. The home of Martin Luther and the birthplace of the Protestant Reformation, Wittenberg was a city that valued freedom of thought and speech, a haven for those who dared to question and challenge the status quo. Here, Bruno found a place where he could continue his intellectual pursuits, unfettered by the constraints of dogmatic doctrines or societal prejudices. His arrival in the city marked the beginning of an important period in his life. A period characterized by unbridled intellectual exploration and prolific writing, as he fully embraced the freedom Wittenberg offered. In 1588, his endeavors culminated in the publication of De la causa principio et uno, a work that encapsulated his daring vision of the universe. This was not a universe confined by the crystal spheres of Ptolemaic cosmology, or centered around the earth as per the religious doctrine. No, Bruno presented a cosmos that was infinite, a cosmos teeming with countless worlds much like our own. Such a vision was not only revolutionary but also profoundly destabilizing, shaking the very foundations of the established worldview. The courage to espouse such an idea, to openly contradict the church and the scholarly consensus, testified to Bruno's unwavering commitment to the pursuit of truth. Yet, Bruno's ideas were not well received in all quarters. Even in a city as tolerant as Wittenberg, his audacious claims attracted controversy and criticism. The freedom he had enjoyed began to wane, forcing Bruno to once again leave. He moved on to Prague in 1589, hoping to find a more receptive audience. In Prague, his ideas again clashed with the prevalent religious beliefs. Despite his hopes, the city offered him little solace. But Bruno, with his indomitable spirit, did not let this dampen his pursuit of knowledge. He continued to write, to debate, to challenge the established norms, embodying the very essence of intellectual bravery. In 1591, Bruno made a decision that would alter the course of his life drastically. He accepted an invitation from Giovanni Mocenigo, a wealthy Venetian, to return to Italy. Despite knowing the church's hostility towards his ideas, Bruno chose to return. He believed that Mocenigo genuinely wanted to learn the art of memory. Little did he know that this decision would set him on a path towards confrontation with the very institution he had once served. Upon his return to Italy, Bruno found himself in a country that had changed in his absence. The dominance of the church was more pronounced, its intolerance for dissenting views more palpable. Nevertheless, Bruno continued his teachings with Mocenigo, steadfast in his commitment to spreading his ideas. But the peace Bruno found in Venice was short-lived. His trust in Mocenigo was betrayed when the latter denounced him, leading to his arrest by the Venetian Inquisition in 1592. Mocenigo's actions revealed a sinister plan, one that had enticed Bruno back to his homeland only to ensnare him in the treacherous grasp of the Inquisition. Accused of heresy, Bruno found himself confined within the walls of a prison, his freedom brutally curtailed. Yet, even as the world turned against him, Bruno stood by his beliefs with a steadfastness that bespoke of his immense courage. In 1593, he was transferred to Rome to face the Roman Inquisition, a process even more rigorous and relentless than the one he'd faced in Venice. As he stood before his accusers in Rome, Bruno was fully aware of the gravity of the charges against him. The threat of torture and execution hung over him like a dark cloud, yet he stood firm, refusing to renounce his ideas. He was an exemplar of intellectual bravery, a man who chose truth over safety, knowledge over ignorance, even when faced with the direst of consequences. The formal trial against Bruno began in 1594. He faced a barrage of accusations, all rooted in his audacious cosmology and religious views. Yet, despite the odds, Bruno chose to defend his beliefs rather than renounce them. His trial stretched on for years, a testament to both the Inquisition's relentless determination to crush dissent and Bruno's unwavering resolve to stand by his beliefs. In 1597, his works were placed on the Index of Forbidden Books, a list of publications deemed heretical or contrary to morality by the Catholic Church. This marked a new phase in his trial, an escalation of the charges against him. It was an attempt to erase his legacy, to silence his voice, but Bruno would not be silenced. He held firm, continuing to proclaim his ideas in the face of mounting pressure. The years of his trial were grueling, a true test of Bruno's fortitude. Yet, even as he was subjected to relentless interrogations and threats, he remained undeterred, his commitment to his beliefs unshaken. In 1599, he was given a final chance to recant, a chance to save himself from the looming threat of execution. Bruno, however, did not hesitate. He refused to recant, choosing to stand by his beliefs even at the cost of his life. His refusal was an act of unparalleled bravery, a testament to his commitment to the pursuit of truth. The price for his defiance was high. In 1600, after 7 long years of trial, Bruno was found guilty of heresy and sentenced to death. The man who had once served the church as a Dominican priest was now condemned by the very same institution. When the verdict was read out, Bruno displayed an extraordinary show of defiance. With a courage that stemmed from the deepest conviction in his beliefs, he declared to the court, "It may be you fear more to deliver judgment upon me than I fear judgment." These powerful words echoed in the hallowed chambers, underscoring the depth of his conviction and his willingness to face the direst of consequences for his beliefs. He met his fate with remarkable courage and dignity, refusing to bow down to the power of the Inquisition. On February 17, 1600, he was burned at the stake in Rome's Campo dei Fiori. As the flames consumed him, Bruno became a symbol of intellectual freedom, a martyr who had dared to challenge the church's authority and paid the ultimate price for it. Bruno's execution marked a grim moment in the history of intellectual freedom. It was a chilling reminder of the power of institutions that sought to control thought and suppress dissent. Yet, Bruno's ideas could not be extinguished with his death. His vision of an infinite universe, his philosophy, his courage, all lived on, reverberating through the ages. Bruno's legacy was one of bravery, of unwavering commitment to his beliefs, and of the pursuit of knowledge, regardless of the cost. He challenged the conventional wisdom of his time, pushing the boundaries of human understanding of the universe. He dared to dream of a cosmos filled with countless worlds, a universe without a center, in stark contrast to the geocentric worldview endorsed by the church. In doing so, he sowed the seeds of a revolution that would reshape our understanding of the cosmos in the centuries that followed.